Hello everyone, this is Jashan and today I am back with a new video and we will be having a quick discussion with my friend Divyanshu and he has been working with the KAUST Saudi Arabia. He has got several opportunities like PhD in IIT Delhi, again intern opportunity in KAUST Saudi Arabia. So today in this video we are going to know about a lot of things. The first thing is the question asked by IIT Delhi, IISc Bangalore and KAUST Saudi Arabia during his interview. And the next thing, how to choose between the industry and academics, like where should you go? And after that, we will be knowing about the IELTS exam and the exam, the procedure to migrate to another country like Saudi Arabia. And what is his stipend in Saudi Arabia and life at IIT Mandi versus life at IIT Delhi. So all these points we will be covering with this discussion. Very starting, like I would like to add here, like you guys have to bear with us some internet issues because he's right now in Himachal. So there might be some technical issues there. Kindly bear with that. So let us start with the introduction of Mr. Divyanshu. Hi, Divyanshu, how are you doing?
Hi, Jason. I'm fine. Thanks for having me. Greetings from my side to everyone. My name is Divyanshu, and let's start with my introduction first. Jason tried to do a bit for me, but let's do it from my side. So my name is Divyanshu, and I received my bachelor's degree from National Institute of Electronics and IT, Aurangabad, Maharashtra, in the year 2018. After that, I joined at IIT Mandi in M.Tech VLSI, and I received my M.Tech degree this year in 2021. And my M.Tech CGPA was around 8.59 out of 10. So it was fairly good. For research purposes, it should be like more than 8.5 to get all the opportunities to apply on everywhere. So after that, after completing my M.Tech, I joined at KAUST as a visiting student. And due to COVID, it was remote and it was online. So I joined under Dr. Hussain Fariborzi in the Integrated and Circuits Group at KAUST. And after working for a few months there, I was selected at IIT Delhi as a PhD grad at the CARE department. So I went and joined there under Dr. Rahul Mishra sir. I worked for a few months there, and in October, I resigned there. And then I again joined at KAUST, but this time at a different group. It was Innovative Technologies Laboratory under Dr. Yahya Masood sir at KAUST Saudi Arabia, and so I'm currently working there.
Okay, that's great. Divyanshu, many of us, like we really don't know about the KAUST. We are not much aware about the opportunities as you have already got. So how did you come to know about the KAUST and tell us something about the KAUST Saudi Arabia?
Yes. So I got the overall question that what you are trying to ask. After the first year of M.Tech, I was like kind of confused what to go for, like whether I should go for internship. So I kind of decided that I would want to go into the academics field. So I started looking for some seniors. The best way to like go for this PhD kind of opportunity is to look for your seniors where they are working and ask your professors. So I started looking for some good universities. So one of my seniors was working as a PhD student there. So he kind of introduced me to the college. So I was able to learn more about the culture there and all other things. So yeah, one of the ways to like ask your seniors and your professors. Other ways to like look for on the internet through QS rankings of universities, like what are the top colleges where you can fit in. So yeah, that's how I got to know about it about KAUST.
Okay, that's great. So Divyanshu, what was the experience of your KAUST and what were the questions you were asked by the interviewer? And can you please tell us?
So I had some interview experience during my M.Tech and PhD interviews here in India. So the interview process at KAUST was like completely different. They are like kind of they give opportunity as if there are several roles. Like you can join as a visiting student, MS student, or a PhD grad. But for the best way to approach for that is to go with the visiting student kind of program so that you have some amount of time to work with the group. So the interview for visiting student was like they start the professor. It is one to one, unlike in India where a group of faculties sit. It is just like one to one, and it will be dependent only on the professor whether he wants to take it or not. So you need to mail the professor, and if he's interested with your CV and SOP, he will call you for an interview. So if your CV and SOP is very good, he might not even take the interview. Like he can give you an opportunity to work as an intern, and if things go well, you can join as a PhD further. But for my case, I was called for an interview, and interview started with the analog circuits, digital circuits designing, some questions related to op-amps, filters, all those stuffs in analog circuits, and in digital circuits, all those flip-flop counters, some basic questions. After that, he went to my MTech project, because this is a research institute, so they are like more interested in the research that you have been doing. So I did my MTech project in neuromorphic circuits using spintronics devices. So he started to ask about neuromorphic circuits, designing spintronics-based devices, how much I know, all those stuff. So the interview was in depth, like I can understand SRAM. Then he went to memory designing, SRAM designing, what will happen if I change the width, like the logical effort of different CMOS, what are the conditions that it will fail, those SRAM structures. So it was like just to get a grip of how much critical decision I can make. So some critical questions related to also the integrators, differentiators, those kind of things. So I think the interview was really at a more difficult side from my experience of all the other interviews, because he was not asking to like what I was comfortable with, what he wanted to check on. So yeah, and the guide was from, he did his PhD from MIT. So yeah, you cannot get away with it. Right. But overall, I saved the day. So it was fine. So it was a good experience. Yeah.
Right. So interview was good. Still, I believe like you were the only student, not that much studious, but still you had your concepts cleared about everything. So I believe like you must have given a very good interview to them.
After my interview, sir said that you were a bit rusty, but I like you. So I take that as a positive.
Okay. Great. So Divyanshu, we have like 23 IITs in India. But when we talk about the IIT Mumbai, it has a different aura, because the environment is different, culture is completely different. So how was your hostel life at IIT Mumbai?
Like, it was awesome. Like, the best thing that could have ever happened in my life was living at IIT Mumbai. And the best choice was not to go to home at lockdown. So I kind of stayed 2 years at the hostel and enjoyed a very luxury life. So IIT Mumbai is like a very beautiful campus. And I will try to compare it with IIT Delhi. Like, I was also worked there for 3 months as a PhD student. But I am going to make a bold statement, but I think that IIT Mumbai is far better in terms of infrastructure, at least, and campus life as compared to IIT Delhi. Yeah. Because IIT Mumbai is newly built, right? So it has better lab resources. The buildings are new. All the equipments are new. And they have less number of students at IIT Mumbai. So it's more spacious and more accessible to in the general students as compared to IIT Delhi. Yeah.
Yeah, you have very well said. Okay, so you had your experience with IIC Bangalore, if I'm not wrong, for PhD position, right?
Yeah.
So what were the questions asked by them for the PhD?
Yeah. IIC Bangalore is like a top institute in India. Everyone knows here. So I applied in computational nanoelectronics. As I remember, the professor was Shantanu Mahapatra sir. So IIC interview, they like really check in depth. So the first thing started is you need to prepare is mathematics. It's like the first question was asked like to plot the Lambert W function. So at that time, I did not know how this function looks like, right? What is the expression? So I had to ask the professor, sir, what is the expression? So he gave the expression, no worries about that. So basically, they'll ask you to first plot some kind of graphs, mathematical function. Suppose y e power minus y, sine e power y, some kind of intermixed function. Better would be to prepare with the books like Amit M. Agarwal, Play with Graphs. So graph questions will come in IIC interview, no matter which discipline or which domain you're applying, to check the basic mathematics ability of a student.
That is true. Even the interviews for MTech, they also ask for the graph questions. Yeah. Because I have experienced it.
Yeah. So maths part is one part that will be asked. Second part was he went to the subject domain, like why I'm applying there. So the problem with me was that I was not very much suitable for that computational nanoelectronics domain because I was working in spintronics field as my thesis, but I had prior experience. So he asked me like, have you taken some formal courses related to quantum mechanics or some formal courses certification online even for machine learning, this kind of stuff. So that is one part with that I lacked. And I think that that was the cause that I did not receive the offer. Other than that, he went to ask about eigenstates value of an electron confined in a potential wave. That is a fairly good question, like fairly standard problem in computational nanoelectronics. Then again, he went to ask, like, to derive the expression for that using the boundary conditions. You need to derive the expression for this eigen state values for energy. So the in computational nanoelectronics or fundamental of nanoelectronics, you will find this kind of quantum mechanics question where an electron in free medium, when it is confined to a certain boundary regions, there will be some energy states will be quantized. Mm-hmm. So that expression derivations you need to know if you are applying in computational nanoelectronics. Other stuffs were related to all this. It revolved around that quantum mechanics part only, quantum electronics. So better would be to have a very good understanding of the fundamental subject which you're applying. If you're applying in microelectronics department, you need to know HEMT and all those scaling effects, all those things you need to know, in detail, energy band diagrams, all those stuff. Okay. But mathematics with graphs, that is one part, your subject domain. And the third thing which most of the student misses is that you need to be very clear during PhD that under whom you are going to apply.
Okay.
You need to select your professor beforehand. You need to see what are the students, who are the students working under him. If possible, get in touch with one of them to get the idea. What are the current research that professor is doing? So you need to be updated. You cannot just join anywhere. You need to be aware what is going on. Yeah.
Well,
it was a good experience.
Great. Divyanshu, in here, most of us have we need to go to the industry to have good package, but you didn't choose that thing. So what was your inspiration to go for the PhD and what was your, basic interest?
Yeah. So I think the main issue with the industry is that the work you will be doing in industry will be confined to a certain number of people. Only your group members will know what you are doing. But if you're in academics, the work you will be doing will be spread over all over the world. First thing is that. Second is that I really hated this 9-to-5 job. So I was like, so I had this thought that research guys are have more flexible timing. But after joining, I came to know that I hated 9-to-5 job. Now I work 24/7. So that's there. But I think the main advantage lies with the flexibility of time. So I can choose, allot my time according to my need, where I want to more emphasis. And I will be not doing work for other guys. I'll be doing, whatever I do for myself. Mm-hmm. And I am getting paid fairly good enough at cost also. I'll come to that part. So this money issue is not there if you are going abroad. It is fairly there in academics in India. Another issue is I was always motivated to learn new things, mm-hmm. Go beyond what is there. I was not interested in working industry, so my technical skills were really bad at that time, but I was good at reading new things. So that kind of was reading stories for me, that part. So that was one motivation. And I wanted to be a good researcher or scientist or a professor in future. So I needed to have a PhD. So I was let's continue with the studies.
Okay, Divyanshu, that's really amazing about your experience. So we have really talked much about the cost. Let us come to the package. So what was your stipend there? And after the full-time offer, what package you will be getting?
Yeah. So at KAUST, they pay generously. They do not hold back in paying. You know, Saudi Arabia is a very rich country. Right. And unlike in India, where the Indian government has to cater the need of so many universities, Saudi Arabia has comparatively few universities, so they kind of take care of them well. Okay. So for visiting student, which is kind of intern, you'll be working remotely, they pay $1,000 per month. So that is around 73,000 to 74,000 after deduction of tax and transaction tax. So you will be getting 73,000 per month during your 6 months internship period. And after you are given this full-time offer as a PhD student, the monthly stipend is $3,000 per month. That comes around 2.5 lakhs, you can check. One thing I like the more is that in India, you get 31,000 per month in PhD, right? So 30, 31, 32, this kind of range. And you get this HRA extra of around, if you are in Delhi, you'll be getting 8,000 per month. So it comes around overall 40,000. You have to manage your all living costs, hostel costs, mess food, and your college fees. Right. Kaus does not, advantage of Kaus is like, not take, they have zero application fee, right? They do not take any fee for application, so you can apply it for free. Second, no tuition fee for college. And you do not have to do TA work. Like for this $3,000, you are not entitled to do any TA work. But at IITs here, it is a very hectic work, right? Because in PhD, you will be like head TAs. So you'll be doing a lot of work. For
even
extra
in MTech,
TA work,
we have to
pay
do a lot
thousand.
Of TA work.
I can like understand the feeling of that part. You can also understand like the IITs, like they really, you have to do a good work in TA also. Right, because you have to teach students and you cannot like let the quality drop. So it was a good learning experience, but the pay was very bad, right? So but at Kaus, like you'll be getting $1,000 extra for TA work if you want to do. Okay. It's not like it is optional, so like you can manage up to $4,000 USD. And another thing about Kaus is like financing is that even the hostel fees are free. You have to pay some amounts to go and attend the conferences. In India, there's like limits to how much you can attend and how much you can spend. But at Kaus, it's kind of like do as much as you can. So in terms of that, they are like very good. Yeah.
Okay. So basically, you have covered the difference between PhD in India and Saudi Arabia. Okay.
Yeah. Right. And another thing is that you don't have to pay any taxes, right? You can make your NRI account and okay. You can skip the tax, so you'll be getting like around 30 lakhs in hand without any tax deduction. That's okay. Kind of fair enough, I guess.
No, because if Saudi Arabia is paying you, then there is no tax by the Indian government. Is it like this?
Because you'll be making your NRI account. I'm not very pretty sure, but if you can make NRI account, you are not entitled to pay tax to Indian government, because you'll be living in Saudi Arabia and you are employed by them. You are not working for Indian government. Okay. So yeah, and you are not living. So the only criteria I think is that you need to stay like more than 182 days to make an NRI account.
Okay.
But I'll get in touch with some CA and like okay. What is the actual position. Okay. But, as far as I know, you don't have to pay taxes.
Okay. So you also have experiences of IIT Delhi, and you have experienced the interview. So can you please tell us about that experience and the questions asked by the IIT Delhi?
So IIT Delhi is like one of the top IITs here, right? So I applied at QA department. I was not selected in E department because of low CGPA at that time. So, but QA department is also very good in terms of faculties. There are very good faculties there. So my interview started with my general introduction. So what I feel about this IIT's interview is that you need to put your introduction in such a way that the questions are asked only from domain you are interested to answer.
So you will be driving your interview basically.
Yeah. So that part is given you at the first chance, like your introduction. So I started my, I wanted to answer more for my MTech thesis project. I did not wanted to answer much from subjects, like they ask favorite subjects, right? So because I was in final semester and I was working, I spent much time during on my thesis rather than preparing for the subject. So I was more confident in this thesis work. Knew what to like, how to drive my interview. So I started with my introduction, which focused more on my thesis, like what I'm doing. And that piqued the interest of one of the professor. I already picked one of the professors there, which I wanted to work under, which was Dr. Rahul Mishra sir, because he worked in spintronics field. So you need to like have an idea which faculties are going to be there present so that you can kind of pitch your, like you are a good PhD student, right? You know what is going on in the research they are doing.
Okay.
So the question started with my MTech thesis. I'll not go into much detail there because it's kind of will not match to other students' field. But the title was Neuromorphic Circuits Using Spintronics Devices. So I was able to answer some questions related to neuromorphic circuits, learning in neural algorithms, and your spintronics devices structure. So the basic idea and what was the motivation? So the basic motivation is that this present-day CMOS-based devices are kind of reaching its bottleneck. And the idea is to keep the Moore's law alive and to fight the von Neumann bottleneck. We are going to some beyond CMOS devices. So in my case, I'm working on the spintronics devices for future computing paradigms. Okay. So that was my area. So that piqued his interest. And Professor Rahul did his PhD from NUS. So I had the opportunity to work with him for 3 months. So I know he's a very cool guy. So he asked some very good questions related to the spin tonation devices. After that, after answering like most of the questions related to the thesis, and after satisfying them, like they were like, they asked like, do you have any other expertise in any other subjects? So you need to prepare some subjects also related to what you're applying. So I said microelectronics and nanoelectronics with some experience of fabrication, because we had this, our C4 FED lab, you know, right, is one of the best in India, right? Absolutely. So they asked questions from microelectronics were like a mechanism of PN junction diode breakdown, like junction breakdown, like the Zener effect and avalanche effect, right? Can we measure the contact potential across a diode? Questions related to Schottky diode, whether it is faster than normal diode or not, and why is that? This kind of question. Then Hall effects, what are the applications that you can do it with it? So yeah, like some basics, this question, band diagram of some structures. Okay. So on first day, it went like this. Then there was another day also. They took it into two rounds. So in second round, they asked more about this project only, and then discussed which professor I want to work under and what will be my like aim and all those stuff. So yeah. So if you are good with your thesis and some strong subjects, if you can clear basics only, so you can clear those interviews at IIT.
Okay, fine. Great. So you have like taken the word spintronics a lot of times. So for our viewers, can you just tell what does that really mean, spintronics devices?
Yeah. So I will really like encourage all the students who are like kind of looking into going into the academics. This spintronic space device, see, all this electronics that we are using, they're all charge-based. We have read equations of charge current flowing through the device, the drift diffusion equation in semiconductors. All those are like expression based on the charge of electrons. But as we know, the electron has also one another quantum principle, like the spin of the electron. So my area focuses with the utilizing the spin as a computational variable. What will happen if we can manage also control the spin of the electron for computation? So it kind of, in the recent years, this kind of gave some interesting results, which are not even possible to be implemented using CMOS-based hardware, like reversible logic, combinatorial optimization, neuromorphic computing. So it offers certain advantages like low power, like non-volatile memory. Like we know there is this bottleneck with the, why does our classical computers cannot scale? It has three like limiting factor: energy, memory bandwidth, and scaling, right? So you cannot scale it beyond, right? You know, we are already hitting 1 nanometer, 2 nanometer. So what will happen after 20, 30 years? So you cannot scale. And the rate at which we need to feed the data into the system is not enough compared to the data we are generating. So this has given rise to go beyond this CMOS-based hardware. So that is one of the areas which is known as beyond CMOS devices. So spintronics is one of the subset. There is this, we know in von Neumann architecture, we have separate memory and computing unit. So there is a data transfer mismatch between the memory and CPU. Because suppose CPU is processing faster and memory is not that much fast to transfer the data. So you'll have to wait, right? So this will create problems. But inspired by our brain, right? Our brain is a very efficient device. So it consumes very less energy and it has some very good pattern recognition abilities. So this works on in-memory architecture, where the memory and the processing takes in the same units. So this is what inspired us to work on, inspired me to work on neuromorphic circuits. Okay. So yeah, okay. One can look into it. And the main advantage I will say is that in terms of job, it will not fetch you a good position right now. But in terms of academics, all the big universities all over the world, even in India, there's a lot of demand for spintronics guys. So VLSI students will have certain advantages because they are from circuit background, right? So right, there are many guys who work with physics and materials, but working on circuits, for spin circuits, you need to have your VLSI background. So that will give you a really good edge over others, and you will not face much competition, and it will be like interesting to work on.
Okay, great. So you have talked about everything. So when you are going to shift to the Saudi Arabia, and what are the formalities you have completed in now?
Yeah. So for applying to any foreign universities, generally you need a valid passport, right? Second thing is during these times you need to have your vaccination, right? So there are some problems related, like Covaxin is not accepted at some part of the world. So Covishield is like mostly generally accepted. Third is you need one of the English language tests you need to clear. So GRE is like universal. If you are not sure which university you'll be joining, so GRE is the best way to go, right? You score as much as you can and then apply to like universities like Stanford and etc. But in my case, I think I was pretty sure which university I wanted to join. So you can check the university you are trying to figure out. And it was IELTS was accepted. IELTS score was accepted. So IELTS academics is like easier to crack, right? Go with IELTS general test, because it is for guys who are like going for jobs and going to stay. IELTS academics is for research guys. It takes less amount of time to prepare. The difficulty level is a bit low, right? Because it does not take much of...
Even 2 days before the test, you were telling me, like, I have my test day after tomorrow. So in just 2 days, you prepared and given good bang.
Yeah. In my case, what happened that I needed to apply it very fast, because I was working at IIT Delhi and I had to resign and then apply, and I needed to have my IELTS score. So just within 15 days of time, I needed to have a valid score. So that put me in a tight spot. So I went for IELTS academics and the cutoff was 6.5. So, and that was like Diwali season and Chhat season in our hometown. So I could not get much time and I had to return back to Delhi. So I got like 3 days of time and then I opened the book. What is this test? What is this ask? So I think IELTS academics is very easy to clear because it has 4 sections. One is speaking, listening, writing, and reading, right? Okay. Speaking, you cannot do much no matter how many days you have. So they'll ask some general questions, right? You need to be clear about the vocabulary, right? You need to be clear with your pronunciation. They are just testing you for whether you can speak properly or not. You can make logical arguments or not. So general questions, for my case, it was asked like, share your experience of a marketplace. What do you think of people buying expensive gadgets even when they don't need it, and what do you think about looking at skies and stars? So I said I don't like watch stars, like I don't have that much time. So you can say anything, right? You don't have to be worried about, just what you're saying is important. So I got 7 out of 9. It is scored out of 9, right? IELTS academics, so 7 out of 9 is good enough, I guess. Then reading was there. Then the second test is LRW, which is listening, reading, and writing. In listening section, you'll be played one audio once, and you need to give the answers based on the conversation. So yeah, that is also, you cannot do anything, right? Listening, you cannot improve your listening abilities, and it is fairly just a practice, like 1-2 test to get the feel how the test is being conducted, right? There are some sample tests available. When you register, you will be allowed to give some sample tests. And they'll give you one book also, so you can download the audios from there. So you need to like give 1-2 mock tests to understand the pattern, that you are not like completely unguarded during the test. Reading section, you'll get passages and you need to answer questions from there. And writing section, you need to be prepared like very good, right? That can drag your score down. You'll be needed to write essays, and you'll be needed to write some critical observations from some graphs, right? So you need to prepare like the format, which things you need to write, which things you do not need to write. You can get those details on the website, IELTS website official, or you can get through YouTube channels, right? There are many good channels, which I prefer. Maybe Jason can share the links of some of those who wants to prepare. So that will be like very helpful. So 2-3 days is enough for engineers, I guess.
Right. Okay. So let me ask you, since your interest was in research, so how many papers you published during your M.Tech, and after M.Tech during PhD, how many you have published, and on which paper currently you are working upon?
So asking you about papers to a research guy is like asking the age of a girl and asking the salary of an employee. So, but it's fine. Like, okay, you are my friend. So what happened is that during my MTech, like I started to work, as you know, on a very new field here in BLSI, and we started to work on spintronics devices. So it was kind of very difficult for me to like just go and publish a good paper. You know, the standards you have to maintain at IITs, you cannot just publish anything. And you also know my guide who was there. So he had a knack for quality papers, right? So during my MTech interviews, I was not able to publish anything, right? Okay. Because, you know, we were kind of disturbed due to this lockdown. And I was not pretty sure what to publish and how to proceed. So that phase comes during this research guys period. But and that also created issue to join, right? But I had some good recommendations and good referrals. So okay. I was able to go for interview because my CV did not contain any publication during my interview at KAUST, right? So that they are research institute. If you don't have publication, it is difficult, right? You need to show. And most of the students who apply are from MS. Not much students apply from MTech, and you know MTech duration is short, and MS guys spend more time doing research, so they have more chances to go into this kind of universities. So after my MTech, just when I cleared the interview, I was able to publish. Currently, I have 3 papers in review. One of them is available on TechRiff, and 2 posters in MMM. One poster is in MMM Intermag, and one was published in this KAUST Open Research Sustainability for Future. Out of the 3 papers, one is in IEDM 2021, which is a very respected conference. One is in Intermag, and the other one is, which I am the first author, is at ISCAS. ISCAS is a circuit-based conference, and I applied in this emerging devices domain. So 3 papers and 2 posters at this site. And also I was able to get some collaboration. With first collaboration I was able to fix was with the IIT Delhi, where I worked with Dr. Rahul Mishra sir. I'll also take this opportunity as a hiring agenda, right? Nothing is for free, right? So if anyone is interested to join our group, they are most welcome. They can get in touch with me and we can discuss more. But KAUST like really encourages for collaborative research. And for that example, IIT Delhi is in collaboration with us, and we are also in collaboration with Spintech from France. So we had some meetings with them, and they were like very kind guys, and they are like top, right? They are situated in France. You can look more upon them. Okay. So yeah, like student exchange programs, transfer of technology, these stuffs are required in research. So, and there is very good interdisciplinary collaboration also. So we are also in collaboration with ICS group in CEMC. Okay. So yeah. So paper publication, some good collaboration. Yeah.
Okay, great. So let me add one thing here for our viewers. If anyone is interested to apply for the research area in as an intern in KAUST or maybe in IIT Delhi, so Divyanshu can refer you for that. He can recommend you very well. So you have to just reach to me or either Divyanshu. I will share you the email ID of Divyanshu. So you can go with that. Okay. So now
Thanks, Jason.
Yeah, sure. Divyanshu, I would like to ask one thing here. Since the students like me, they generally get confused like what to choose in after MTech first year. We should go to industry or we should go to research work. So how to choose between these two things?
Yeah. I think I'll be able to answer it more easily based on my experience.
Okay.
Whenever we join in MTech, right, especially at IITs, we come from different backgrounds, different colleges, right? So we may not have a very good alumni base during our BTECs, right? So in academics, this alumni contact is important. So when I was in first year of my MTech, I started to give random interviews of industries, right? Like you can remember the Siemens one I gave, TCS research intern. I was able to clear both of them. So one thing is about those things is that about industry, like I did not find it myself to be very suitable, right? So during the first year of itself, you need to be very clear what you want to do. The stigma related to PhD, doing PhD, is that because you're not getting any good jobs, you're going for PhD. That is kind of perception, right? Only those who cannot get a job kind of go to PhD in India, right? That is the general overview perception. So that kind of hurts. So you need to be very clear, right? What are the things available? Doing PhD in India is very difficult. not just in terms of academic pressure, but it's in comparison to infrastructure research opportunities. So it will create a very lot of pressure. So I don't think it is a good choice if you are confident enough in yourself to go, unless you are like really confident, really confirmed, or some other conditions that like you cannot leave India and you are interested in academics. So you need to be very clear about what you want to do, like whether you want to go to the industry or you want to go to the research. That is a personal choice. If you want to go to industry, there are various resources available. Like Jason is giving some very good opportunity to all of you to have interview experiences. Right? That is very important. We lack those things. There was no one to share their experience. So this is very important to understand. If you want to go to industry, get in touch with the guys who are working there, some of their experience, how to prepare, what kind of schedule you should follow in terms of academics. I'll talk more about the guys who are interested in academics. So I was able to like clearly distinguish that I want to go into this field. That is very important. You do not want to put your legs on both the boats. I want to go to industry. I want to go to the academics. At this stage, at the M.Tech stage, it is not a good choice because you will feel the pressure from your peers, right? They will be getting good jobs and you will be kind of confused. So try to go into one direction and you can let us switch. Like it is very common to switch between industry and academics, right? We have seen many examples. So just try to build one base. For in terms of academics, if you are not very sure which topic is very important, guide is very important, group is very important, which where you want to go, which country, which college. So try to get in touch with your seniors. And until then, try to figure out, do some research-related projects, like we had this winter project or thesis project. M.Tech students will generally face more difficulties, as I said before, because of the short duration of their project. So they kind of may be floating like me for 6 months, right? And get in touch with your seniors, whether they are working in some universities or not. You need to take it case by case, right? If someone is working there, it will be easier for you to get the recommendation and referrals. So getting the interviews is very difficult, right? In my case, I remember I mailed to the professor 2-3 times and he did not reply. During the interview, he said to me that you did not have any publications, so I did not feel the urge to reply to you. So these things will come. If you don't know anyone, it will be difficult to get the hang of it. So those guys who are interested in academics, be very clear whether you want to be in India or abroad. In India, challenges are more, but you'll be more comfortable in terms of your lifestyle, right? Because you know everything here, how things go. But I think dream big and go for the best, right?
So with this, we have covered a suggestion for our VLSI students and tips for those. Okay, so, and thanks for your appreciation, Divyanshu. Okay.
Yeah, sure enough. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So with this, we have covered the interview discussion with Divyanshu. And it's really pleasure to have him here. And he has absolutely told everything about the research area, his thoughts about the industry, his thoughts about the IIT Delhi, IIT ISC Bangalore, and most importantly, KAUST Saudi Arabia. So we wish good luck to the Divyanshu, and thanks. Thank you very much, Divyanshu. Thanks.
Thanks, Jason. Thanks to all the viewers. And don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button, okay?
Yeah,
you are getting so much good information out of him. So give some love also. And you can contact me for any, if you have any general doubts also.
Right.
So I'll be happy to be answering all of those.
Right.